thank you again for tuning in to another segment where we're bringing it to you real, we're bringing it to you raw, and we're sharing our aha moments with you. I want to introduce one of our special guests a little bit later, but she is the CEO and founder of Changing Faces Studios, and she has done phenomenal work, not just here in Houston, but nationally. So I want you to stay tuned in, because now you're plugged in, tuned in, tapped in to Outside the Box. Without further ado, I want to introduce you all to Michelle Cofield, the CEO and founder of Changing Faces Studios. Everybody give a round of applause.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for having me.
Yes. So now that you're here, I want you to be able to tell the world what it is that you do and how you got started.
My name is Michelle Cofield, as she stated, and I am a published makeup artist and / licensed esthetician. A lot of people don't know that I do skin therapy, because they focus so much on the makeup, but I do skin therapy also, and I know a lot about skin. They kind of go like hand in hand. But my journey started, you know, so many times you have so many fears, and I know in college I had we had to state like our three fears that we had, mm-hmm. and one of my fears was losing a parent. Mm-hmm. And in 2012, I lost my mom, and it was like really sad. I was in a low place. I was lost. And especially, like, you know, you go to your mom's house and you go for cookouts and right. you go for just go visit and, you know, everything. So when I lost my mom, suddenly I said, you know what? I was just like, why? What's my purpose? And so nothing happened the next day. Mm-hmm. But the next day after that, I woke up and I just wanted to do makeup, and it was just crazy. I might have had like one foundation, a couple of pencils, a couple of lipsticks, but it was different. I never did makeup before, mm-hmm. at all, and I was just hungry for it. Like, I really, really wanted to do makeup. So I have a 15-year-old at the time, and I would wake up like 3 o'clock in the morning, 12 o'clock, 7 o'clock. I was like, come on, let me do this on your face. And she was like, mama, I'm tired, mama.
You was hungry.
Yes, huh? I was hungry for it. So I just kept practicing on her. And at the time, I was just focused on the eyes. I wasn't focused on the whole face. Mm-hmm. So I'm just doing, you know, just the eyes. So I had a few ladies that, you know, they came and got their makeup done. But it was just like, just basic stuff. Mm-hmm. And I was like charging like $25, because that's what I thought it was worth. And oh my goodness, I looked at makeup today. My friends was nice to me, yeah. because their makeup was a mess.
Oh Lord,
it was a mess. But it was just like I kept practicing and practicing and practicing. And so then later on, I was reading like anybody could be an MUA. You don't have to have a license for that. So I was like, I want to be a licensed makeup artist, because they'll pay you more if you're licensed. Right. So I looked up this school in Stafford, and it was Ogle Beauty School. And so I went there, and I was like, Michelle, there's no way you're going to be able to get in this class, because it's $11,000, one. You work for immigration, two. They're not going to give you a grant, three. So I was like, I'm just not going to even, not knowing that I asked God for my purpose, I just went on to the school. I walked around, and I filled out the paperwork, and I left. They called me the next day. I wind up going back and going over the paperwork, and they said, okay, well, everything looks good. And so I'm still doubting. Like, I'm not getting into school. Mm-hmm. So I wind up, they called me the next day, and they said, you're going to start school on Tuesday. Oh, and I'm wow. hyped up. I'm like, ooh, I get to start school.
Yeah.
But I go to work from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. I live in Lake Jackson at the time. I lived in Lake Jackson. And then the school is in Stafford.
Oh, wow.
My job is on the north side. It's 75 miles one way, just there. So I would go to school from 8 to 4. I go to work from 6 to 6. I was literally up like 3 days at a time. And when I was off, I had to pack clothes for 3 days at a time and leave my daughter at home, hoping she gonna take her tail to school. Showering in motel rooms for $20 a day. Just going without no sleep. So it was like really, really tiring. And I wound up finishing school and getting licensed. So when you get a license, you kind of like, I'm ready. You so ecstatic about where you're going to start and where you're going, what you're going to do. You're going to be a boss. You're going to do this. It don't work like that. So I wound up working in a salon for a couple of years, but I always like, I'm going to work for myself. Mm-hmm. So I got together with a couple of coworkers and we were talking and he said, you want to call yourself Miss Changing Faces. And I was just laughing like, that's so funny. We going to be laughing at this Miss Changing Faces stuff.
Yeah.
And I wanted to call myself Miss Changing Faces. I looked up Changing Faces Studios. Did nobody have the name but with an S, and I changed it to a Z. And so I was like, I want to do a logo. My friend, she's like, you ought to have like a black and white logo because you do all types of faces.
So how long have you been doing makeup now?
I've been doing makeup professionally since 2014. It'll be 6 years in April.
Wow. Well, I actually have a video of some of your makeup.
Oh, wow.
I want the world to check it out.
Slide on the pimp game with my pinky ring. Lot of gang, lot of bzzz in the icy chain. While you claim that you rich, that's a false claim. I be straight to the whip, no baggage claim. Whole lot of styles, can't even pronounce the name. You ain't got no style, see you on my Instagram. I be rocking it like it's fresh out the pen. Only when I'm taking pics, I'm the middleman. Walk talking like a boss, I just lift a hand. 3 million cash, call me Rain Man. Money like a shower, that's my rain dance. And we all in black, like it's gangland. Say the wrong words, you be hangman. Why me stick to your like a spray tan? Mister, what kind of car you in? In the city, love my name. Gotta say it. She can get a taste. She can get a taste. Wouldn't say it's all the same like Mary Kay.
Now, since you started doing makeup, it has taken you on a vast journey.
Yes.
And I've seen you work with models and magazines, and I actually want to, you know, I want to share a few of your steals with the world while we discuss this. I wanted to dig a little bit and find out, how did you get the opportunity to become published? Because you don't see a lot of African-American MUAs published, and I see that you have a diverse style where you don't just do African-American faces. You do faces of all nationalities.
Yes.
So I want you to share, like, how did you get into the publication side of your career?
How I got into the publication side, well, you said I do all types of faces. At first, it didn't start off like that. I was like, I'm going to do nothing but women of color. And when I thought about it, I was like, no. I want all the money. I want all of it. So the only difference is the shades. That's it.
Yeah.
So that's why I diversified my brand, because I was like, I'm just not going to work with just women of color, even though I love my people.
Mm-hmm.
But I just want to be more diversified, and you can get more money, more everything with being diversified. But how did I start doing publications? A young lady, I did her makeup one day, and she came back and she said, will you come to my photo shoot with me? And I said, photo shoot? And you know, you're nervous. You don't know what to expect. You think it's 100 people on set. Mm-hmm. They're going to be watching you. And she was like, no, it's a TFP. And at the time, I didn't know what TFP mean, mm-hmm. which means trade for photos. There's no money exchange, but everybody is working together for a common cause to get great photos and to build their portfolio.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, sure, I'll come. So I went to the shoot with her. I went through a lot of photographers.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, when you go through a lot of wrongs, you know what a right look like.
Yeah.
So when I went to this shoot, that's when I met my first photographer that he's still with me today, Felix Valerie.
Shout out to Felix.
So she shot with him, and it wasn't nothing like I thought. It was just a quiet set. I did her makeup, stood in the background, touched it up, changed a little few things, but it was a great shoot. And I exchanged numbers with Felix, and I was telling him, you know, I'm just trying to build my portfolio. And so when we got the pictures back, I was like, okay, these pictures look really, really good. So I kept in contact with him, and I was telling him, you know, I want to build my portfolio and all this stuff. And so we began working together.
Mm-hmm.
And for the first year, I paid, you know, because you really don't know people, you have to pay them.
Right, right.
Because you don't want to get an exchange where you do not get your photos.
Right.
So I was like, oh, let me pay him. So for the first year, I wanted to jump into like the creative side.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, people don't really know that you do makeup. So you have to start with beauty. So I was like, man.
Mm-hmm.
So we was building our portfolio, working together. And I really liked the work. And the models just kind of like fell in my lap. Like, I guess when you have something or you're doing something that's good, you don't have no problem with people trying to come.
People will see your light. They're just drawn to light naturally.
Exactly. And so me and him just kept working together. And then, like, after the next year over, he was like, just go. And so that's when I started the creative stuff. And it was with glitter and just crazy stuff. And I think, like, with every photographer, for the submissions for a magazine, it's up to the photographer. If they have that eye, they say, okay, we should go for a publication. It's their that's their job to submit.
Okay.
If we collaboratively say, oh, yeah, these pictures are good enough to go for a magazine, and that's how we began. I have been getting published since year one.
Yeah.
And they submit, and if the magazine likes it, then you're in the magazine.
Now that you're doing, like, you're published, you're doing photo shoots, you're styling, and mm-hmm. you're doing so many wonderful things.
Yep.
You're even working with fashion shows, and you're traveling out of the state. How is that being, you know, involved and so a part of living your life outside the box?
It's really, really fun. You get to meet a lot of great people. I have a great team that I work with, and it's just awesome. I actually got to go with Jeanette Hill to New York Fashion Week last year, and it was awesome.
I love Jeanette Hill.
It was okay.
That is my stylist, everybody. Shout out,
man.
To
she be dressed out my models, and so usually when I try to call her, she's usually here, and she'll dress them for me, and we just collaborate well. And she done got published also, so that's a good thing. But you get to meet a lot of extraordinary people,
mm-hmm.
and you get to meet people like yourself that's hungry and trying to do stuff. And I don't think, like, the whole time that I've been doing this that I've come across anybody that it's a few.
Mm-hmm.
It's a few that will get under your skin, but it's just great. Everywhere I go, it's just awesome.
Okay. Now that you're starting to see the fruits of your labor, and more people are becoming aware of your gift, your clients are booming, your shoots are everywhere. Every time I look up, you're in a different publication. How has that changed the dynamic of your relationship with the people that have been in your life? Like, you know, a lot of times success kind of brings out either the best or the worst in people. So how has that affected you and your journey?
Well, first I told you about the purpose with God. And the thing is when you consistently have a relationship with God and you say, okay, I need you to remove and replace people and put them in my life. When he started removing and getting people out your way, you can't say, oh, no, go back. Not that
not
one.
That one.
Not
right.
that one.
Sometimes those ones that hurt like, the most. Be like, Lord, but I didn't want to let that one go.
Exactly.
Can I just keep it a little bit? No, God, say
no. Yeah. Let me show you again, dummy. And he'll show you something else. But I can say with that he has replaced and removed a lot of people that you think that's going to be with you for a long time. And don't get me wrong, I still love all my people genuinely. But at the same time, when you when you have people in your life and they get removed, sometimes you pay more attention to the people that don't support you than the people that do. Mm-hmm. And it's a distraction. So you have to get those people out the way in order to be focused on the people that really showing you that love, that support. You know, so it's a journey. I have a lot of support from my friends but all that drama and stuff, I don't have all that stuff no more. So yeah. Girl, I've been doing really, really good getting everything.
That's amazing. to walk into your light and have a support team. You know, it's almost like you need it. There's no I in team. And so when you're surrounded by greatness, it helps you be great. It's almost mm-hmm. like having great accountability partners. Mm-hmm. Now, what advice would you give someone that wants to do what you do?
You have to practice. Make sure it's something that you want to do. Mm-hmm. Make sure that you just don't want to start this today and then say, no, I don't want to do it. Be open-minded, because you is going to get those clients that you're not going to satisfy. Mm-hmm. Make sure this is something you want to do and be consistent with it. If you keep on practicing, find you some cousins, nieces, you know, anybody just to practice on, because practice make perfect. Read up on your craft. Don't always look to YouTube as an outlet, because some of these MUAs, when I first started, it was a lot, but it wasn't as many as it is today. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of people have come to mock the craft. And if I say, well, do you have correct, how do you foundation match, or how do you color correct or something? And they have no idea what I'm talking about. And so that's the thing. Study up on your craft. Learn from the greats. Don't let nobody tell you, oh, you can't do this, that, and other. Build you a kit for yourself. Mm-hmm. Don't build your kit according to somebody else. Mm-hmm. Because they might have things in their kit, and you go buy something that's in their kit, and you don't even know how to work it. Master the stuff that's in your kit. Mm-hmm. It don't matter if it's $2 or $200.
Right.
You know?
I get some of my best eyeshadow from the beauty supply. Straight up.
Best. Yeah. Best things. You know.
Now, if it was something that you could do differently, what would that be?
Nothing.
Oh, that's amazing.
I wouldn't do nothing, because I feel like your life is already wrote out. Mm-hmm. God wrote it out. Mm-hmm. So I think there are lessons and blessings. Mm-hmm. And when you have things that make you fall down an obstacle, it's going to make you stronger, but it's going to be able to help somebody else. So they say, oh, you did this and you accomplished that. Mm-hmm. Then I can do it too. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't change anything. Zero. Because right. I wouldn't be able to be sitting here with you and right. telling the story today.
Now, in comparison, where would you say you were like the most, you know, a lot of times we jump out, we want to chase our goals. And someone asked the question to me, like, what was my biggest, challenge? And I honestly said that consistency was my challenge, simply because you jump out there not realizing how much work it takes.
Yeah.
And then when you get in the thick of it, when you're tired, you still have to show up for you. There's no sick days when you have to show up for you.
Exactly.
So on your journey of not having a sick day to show up for you, what can you say was like maybe the toughest time that you can reflect on that you feel like was a great character builder for you? Because I already when you told me about your drive back and forth to school and
the
work
sleep.
And
oh, the sleep
the no
was,
sleep, like that. That,
that was really, really, that was really, really hard. I think my whole thing was getting over the fear. Mm-hmm. The fear, and you know, fear is not of God. So my whole thing was the fear of doing anything by myself and seeing, going somewhere blind. Mm-hmm. And not knowing what's going to happen tomorrow. And that stuff scared me, like, really, really bad. Like, am I going to be able to do this? It was hard for people, for when I got into this business and being in the public, for people to tell me no. Mm-hmm. They don't want to come to me. And I used to always get inside my head and say, oh, they don't want to come to me because I'm not good enough, or they don't want to deal with me because my price too high, or something like that. The most thing was getting in my own head. Mm-hmm. And letting fear stopped me from doing anything. And right now, I just can't do that. I can't live that way. I just say, okay, if I fall on my face,
man,
I get
I got
right
the
back
fearless
up.
And free right here.
Yeah,
in
I'm
front
about
of
to
me.
Get this, I'm about to scrape this old knee off and try it again.
Yeah.
So it is what it is. You have to try and do things in life. If you don't try, you will never know.
No.
I know my people, I always say, the worst people can say is no. They can't cut you. They can't stab you. They can't kill you. Mm-hmm. They just say no. So mm-hmm. when they say no, just keep it moving.
Now, another thing I wanted to ask you, which is a personal question, because I heard you say, which would have been hard for me because I'm a mom too, and I went through a period of time where I was a single mom. Mm-hmm. And being a single mom and an entrepreneur and you're working in corporate America while building your brand doesn't give you any downtime to even take care of yourself. Mm-hmm. Like, how
exactly.
was that having to sacrifice so much time away from your baby to now build a brand that she can depend on? Because a lot of people, you know, they talk themselves out of that sacrifice, but it's really for a greater good because you're creating generational
exactly.
wealth right now.
Exactly.
But how was that going through it?
It's hard. I still have to go through that because... Mm-hmm. I come from a small town, from Angleton.
Shout out Angleton.
And when you're trying to be something bigger, mm-hmm. I love my city, but you want the money to come in repetitiously.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to make the decision, like, I love it because it's quiet here and I don't have to deal with all this and everybody, so much is going on in Houston. So I said I had to make the decision to leave. Mm-hmm. And my daughter, she moved to Pennsylvania, you know, near my sister. And my son, he still lives where I'm from. And so, and they each have grandkids, you know, a child. I'm talking about they
a
each
child,
have grandkids.
Grandma.
I have grandkids. So I knew that I wasn't going to be able to see them all the time. And it's still hard. Like, I don't even get to see my grandkids and get to play with them and all that because I have to come somewhere where the money is steadily going
to
come in.
Right.
And so it's really, really hard. So I get to talk to my son on the phone. I don't really get to see my grandkids. I see one on FaceTime, but it's like, it's going to all pay off.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard. Like,
thank you for saying it,
because
I just got teary-eyed. Because I sometimes don't see my grandbaby. So.
Yeah.
Anyway,
it's
y'all
gonna
just
be
had
good.
A real
you
moment.
Gonna be good. It's gonna all pay
moment,
off.
But yeah, it's
I
the
promise.
Sacrifice. The sacrifice is sometimes tough.
Yeah,
we make these sacrifices for the greater good. So I'm really hoping that people that are tuning in, especially brown girls like us,
yes.
can see your story and see that you stuck it out.
Yeah,
and you've gotten so far. I wanna bring up your website to, you know, let people know where they can go to book you, see some more of your fabulous work, some of the awesome models that you've had an opportunity to work with. So,
oh,
you know,
wow, I did that.
You did all of that, ma'am. And there's just so much growth in your craft as I followed you from the first time I met you through Miss Jeanette Hill.
And
so,
I have I want to give my photographers a shout out because without them, it's no Michelle. I have one photographer. His name is Jay Will. I have another one named Stevie D.
Okay.
They take awesome photos. Ken Robinson, Dante Kenny, Jay Raphael. I've shot with him. And the list just goes on. And so God just put them here. And I'm just hoping that I could just create more with them. But I've shot with them. And it's just awesome.
So for your booking, do you suggest that people go through your website to book you, your Instagram? How do you have that set up?
They can always visit the website at www.changeyourfacesstudios.com. But I have a Acuity scheduling set up now,
mm-hmm.
so they can book themselves. And
okay.
the link be usually in the bio
okay.
on Instagram. And I used to have Miss Changing Faces MUA on Instagram, but I changed it to Changing Faces Studios. I know the following is low, and people are like, what's going on? But I started getting more ghost followers, and the engagement started going down. And I had a lot of major brands follow that account, and so I had to just get rid of that and start all the way over.
Again. Sometimes it's good to start from scratch because, you know, people put so much status on social media numbers, but your proof is in the print.
Thank you.
Your proof is definitely in the print, and you have done such an amazing job doing that.
Thank you so much.
So, do you have any upcoming projects? Any fashion show that you're going to be working with? Anything?
I have two makeup classes. One is going to be a beauty school. It's going to be kind of private. It's for the students that are there. But I'm having a makeup class in May, and I'm gonna have like all the details, and I'm gonna have the tickets uploaded by probably next week.
Okay.
And it's gonna be at Vision Light Studios, which is Stevie D, the photographer I was stating. That's his studio, and I'm gonna have it over there. So everybody need to come out for that. So everybody look, be on the lookout for that.
Yeah, well, I'm looking forward to you
and I
styling
have
me for my okay. next shoot. So yeah, changing faces is gonna be changing my face.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I have I'm working on my lash line right now. So
oh, that's brown girl magic already in the building.
I want some money.
Yes, bring the money, bring the money. So I just want to kind of like thank you,
for being so
transparent, you know,
thank
about,
you, so much.
You know, what you've been through, your support team, how it happened for you, because some people don't realize that all it takes is to believe in yourself.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
Betting on yourself is sometimes the hardest bet to take. But we risk our time, our passion, our energy so much building everyone else's brand because we're afraid that us alone aren't enough when
exactly.
really God gives us all the gifts that we need. We
exactly.
possess it within ourselves. We just have to be intentional with them. And so you setting out the intention when you first started with your two palettes and your pencils, it brought you a long way.
Yes.
And I just want to commend you for
thank
sticking
you so much.
to the path, to the journey, for being an inspiration to
and
me.
And it's still going.
And
it's like
so
still.
Many others, glamorous, fabulous grandmas
okay.
in the building.
Okay.
I did not know you was a grandma.
Yes,
out.
I'm a granny.
Yeah, so I thank you.
Thank
I
you
wanna
for having
thank
me.
Our guests for tuning in to another awesome segment. I was emotional this segment. I'm just, I got chills just listening to her story, and
yes.
I'm thanking her for her transparency.
Thank you.
I want you guys to be sure to tune in to our next segment next week where we'll have two wonderful life coaches. We'll have Ricky Getwood and we'll have Marsha McCray. They're both authors and life coaches, and they're going to share us some insight into, you know, just being outside the box, believing your brand, changing your thinking, reprogramming, and being intentional. So be sure to tune in, same time, same place. Thanks again. I'm your host, Onney, the CEO, and you're watching Outside the Box.